Ladies and gentlemen, have you ever heard of Glenn Gould, the Canadian pianist who lacked the proper technique to play Beethoven's Hammerklavier Sonata as he should? And if you think this opening line was meant to be ironic, you're quite right. But still, if Gould had the technique Beethoven required, why would he play this infamous sonata so much slower than all the other pianists? But don't worry, Gould is in good company. According to the German Staatliches Institut für Musikforschung, the State Institute for Music Research, no living pianists play the Hammerklavier Sonata a tempo. The researchers in this 2021 article zoomed in on recordings by no less than 45 pianists, made over a period of almost 100 years. And they are all too slow. No one matches the famous 138 given by Beethoven as the required tempo. Now, you may say, all well and good, but are we so sure Beethoven's marking was correct? Well, Beethoven metronomized his Hammerklavier Sonata for his student Ferdinand Ries. Ries lived in London at the time and received the instructions in a letter dated 16th April 1819. And Ries didn't complain about these tempi being too fast. Nor did Karl Czerny, who premiered the sonata a few weeks after its completion and later wrote that the work was not easy because of the tempo marking, but required no more than some attentive practice. In the overview of this German Music Institute, you can see, in addition to the name of the pianist, also the tempo in which he or she played the first movement. 138 is Beethoven's tempo. In Beethoven's eyes, a simple allegro. Too fast for the most gifted virtuoso of today, and for many by quite a margin. Let's see what possibly could have gone wrong. But first, let's rewind to that German study. The incentive to collect this information was the famous lecture and interviews that Andras Schiff gave about Beethoven's masterpiece, in which he claimed the 138 was the obvious tempo for this piece. The researchers had to say this about Schiff's claim.
In general, since the 1970s, the conviction becomes increasingly common that it is virtually impossible to continue to ignore the only existing metronome marking given to a piano sonata by Beethoven. One even encounters now statements of this kind from pianists based on whose performances of the Hammerklavier Sonata one would not expect them from. In a conversation with Martin Mayer from 2007, Andras Schiff suggests, quote, that one-sided monumentalization performances have distorted the true image of the sonata, unquote. Schiff recommends the, quote, tempo precisely given by Beethoven in metronome numbers, unquote, as the antidote, and comes to the conclusion, quote, whoever takes the half note at 138 offers himself and the audience the opportunity to explore the dancing, rhythmically charged presence of the first movement, unquote. On his own recording, Schiff plays the first movement at an average tempo of half note equals 104.4.
In the overview, we indeed see that Schiff with 104 remains far below Beethoven's 138. At the very top is Arthur Schnabel with 131. Still too slow, but already with the price of almost countless errors. And at the very bottom, we indeed find Glenn Gould dangling. We started this video with the provocative thought that Glenn Gould plays so slowly because he lacked technique, that I quickly corrected myself. I've learned to be wary of irony on the internet and especially on YouTube. And yes, let's be serious here. Gould could outperform 99% of you watching this video right now, including myself, with his left hand only, while playing chess with his right hand, and probably win there as well. So the question becomes even more intriguing. Why did he take such a slow tempo for this part? Almost half of what Beethoven required. Did he just give up? And if so, give up with what? But before we try to answer that question, let's do something else. I can hear many of you now thinking, all well and good, but why should we follow Beethoven's tempo? Everyone is free to do what they want with music from the past, right? And why couldn't Beethoven appreciate a different tempo? My answer to the first question is, of course! No one is accountable to Beethoven. Why not play Beethoven's or other music the way you like it? But that's not something most of this list of 45 pianists aspires to do. Many of them, and by extension most professional musicians, still have the general idea to express the intention of the composer as much as possible. And let's be honest, you as a listener expect that too in some way, shape or form. Some kind of integrity on the part of the interpreter. Almost no musician will introduce their concerts by saying that they consciously do not pursue the intention of the composer's plate. Incidentally, that is exactly what prompted this German institute to make this study. Schiff was singled out because he made perhaps the most explicit claim to authenticity of all. But that doesn't change the fact that every name on this list, except for Gould perhaps, will confirm that his or her recording is as close as possible to Beethoven's intent, and there is no reason to doubt their honest intentions about this. Leaves us with the question if Beethoven's tempo is so important for this kind of integrity. That's a very good question with an easy answer. Yes, it is. You see, tempo is the foundation of any interpretation. The slightest change in tempo changes the look and feel of a composition. And it's not me who claims this. This is something every professional musician knows. That's also the reason that at this level, you will not meet pianists who play one day a sonata in New York at a completely different tempo than at the next concert a week later in Amsterdam. Schiff's measured tempo of 104 for the Hammerklavier is undoubtedly the tempo he'd take if you call him up right now with the request to play the opening of the famous Opus 106. The reason for this is not a lack of imagination, but the creation of a unity in play and interpretation in which the tempo is no less than the binder. That was also true for Beethoven, by the way. Hear what he wrote 3 months before his death to his publisher Schott.
The metronome markings will be sent to you very soon. Do wait for them. In our century, such indications are certainly necessary. Moreover, I have received letters from Berlin informing me that the first performance of the symphony, that is to say the ninth, was received with enthusiastic applause, which I ascribe largely to the metronome markings.
His student Karl Czerny, would later repeat this phenomenon in much sharper terms as follows.
Any musical piece produces its proper effect only when it is played in the exact degree of movement prescribed by its author, and any even inconsiderable deviation from that time, whether as to quickness or slowness, will often totally destroy the sense, the beauty, and the intelligibility of the piece.
But now back to Glenn Gould. What possessed him to play the sonata so terribly slowly? And no, it wasn't because he couldn't go faster. His tempo was a conscious choice. We know that he was looking for other ways, innovation, to give old music that had been recorded so many times a new lick of paint, letting go of all traditional ties, bonds that he honestly thought were based on certain authenticity. The question arises whether Gould, by breaking all ties with tradition and entering into a one-on-one dialogue with his music, in this case, got closer or further away from the composer's intention. Well, that mystery is solved once you use the metronome as it was used back then, and as physicists still count today, 1 and 2 and 3. So every 2 ticks or full cycle as 1.
Swing the bob to one side and leave it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10.
Instead of 1, 2, 3, with every single tick as we do today. We call that the whole beat metronome practice, the WBMP. Basically, this means all metronome marks from that period become half the value we think they represent today. Not half as slow as performances of today. Many of these metronome marks are so incredibly fast that we've given up a long time ago to reach those speeds. And trust me, even if we could, you as a listener would run away screaming, unless you like your music to be served like this. No worries if you like this fragment. Digital techniques are finally able to produce these tempi for which we humans have been falling short for more than a century. But all joking apart, I don't know if you're hearing this for the first time or not, but if you haven't heard about this before, I imagine you're shocked, skeptical, or maybe even a little annoyed. There's so much more to this ancient phenomenon than I can explain in this video. Take a look at the library of videos on this channel to find some more information, or become a Patreon and find a library of even more detailed explanations, or else just wait another year for our 700-page book on this exact subject to appear. Put your name on our mailing list so you don't miss any updates on this project. Links in the description box. And about Gould? Well, in some cases, purely by instinct, he applied this whole beat principle. We already talked about his Appassionata and also the controversy around Brahms's first piano concerto. But his interpretation of this first movement of the Hammerklavier Sonata, in my opinion, also moved closer to Beethoven than any other version we hear today. Except maybe this one. Thank you. Just one element for you to think about. Ever thought why Beethoven only used eighth notes as fastest note value in this piece? Would you use eighth notes if you had a tempo in mind that was almost comparable to the speed of light? Just think about it. For now, thanks for watching. We see each other soon again. Bye.